welcome you. We welcome you on behalf of our president, Madam Barbara Brown Simmons, and the board members sitting to your right. We welcome all the public officials and dignitaries. I have the distinct privilege and the honor of introducing someone that's very, very close to me, Mr. Joseph Padre. Joseph Padre, he's a serviceman. He went to the service to defend our country. He's a citizen of the United States and of the state of New Mexico and Texas. I wasn't gonna leave that out. It's fitting that he would be the master ceremony tonight because he was also one an outstanding athlete here at the University of Mexico. He did pro ball. He came from Gary and now Chicago by way of College of Mississippi. I've never seen one that could just do that thing and go over. I said that was magnificent. He was in sports, but he also had a passion for what was right and wrong in America. During his days when he was running track, there was a situation with Brigham Young University where I ain't got my 2 minutes, I've just been 30 seconds. Hold up. There was a protest at Brigham Young University because they had a racial clause that said that blacks were descended from Cain, so we were inherited in fury. Well, Joe, along with other athletes throughout the Western Athletic Conference, track wore black socks when they went on the track field. The football player wore black armband. Of course, that law was changed in 1976. So they no longer have a racial clause. That was Joe Padre. Now on the other side, Joe Padre, when we were fighting to get the state holiday for Martin Luther King Day, he would come with his drum every on January 15th. And we got the state holiday passed before the national holiday. Joe is a dedicated father, grandfather, dedicated husband, and he sought to carry his father's business, Padre, to another level. He said, I want to be on 4th Street, not to be around anyone, but because I want a historical building. And that building still exists at 4th Street. And also how Martin Luther King and Malcolm X were in the College of Law, the Lonnie King, when they came to the performance. Let me bring this man forward, Mr. Joseph Padre.
Hey, look at me. We're going to have a real lovely time tonight. Let me say that first. Because we have a ceremony, we have a celebration here. Anytime people can get together and look back in time and appreciate people who have gone on to bigger and better things and come through, Mexico's greatest institution of higher learning. Anybody with me on that?
Amen.
University of Mexico. Anyway, what I want to do as briefly as I can, as timely as I can, but I want you all to relax a little bit and appreciate the stories that you hear that represents these individuals. I first and foremost want to say there's two things that fill my mind just given this opportunity. And one of them is institutions. That one is encouragement. And I look back on you and him, that's what it has turned out to be, sworn meetings, it's an encouragement. I've been able to reach some of the heights in my life as a result of being a student athlete here. I still feel that way about it, and that's what the enrollment association wants to celebrate.
Institutional encouragement.
So y'all stay with me on that, because I'm gonna talk about it as we go along. Right now, we'll get out of your way for a second. And I'll bring this Barbara Simmons up.
Well, actually, is Dana G. Allen in the audience? Here she is. She is being recently hired.
She is the recently hired Vice President of Alumni Relations, Executive Director of Alumni Relations. And before she comes up, I see our provost has to leave. We're going to call him up first to give his welcome on behalf of the president of the University, Robert Frank, who had an emergency. And then we'll call up Dana.
Thank you. Thank you very much. On behalf of the my name is Shawki Abdallah. For those of you who don't know me, I'm the provost at the University of New Mexico. For many of you, probably when you were here, I don't think you had a provost at the time. You know, something that I think it was called Vice President for Academic Affairs. But Robert Frank, our president, is not able to be with us, so he asked me to welcome you back. Many of you to your university. You know, I work with some of you on issues regarding our students and our programs at the university, and I'm honored to learn more about what you've achieved. I want to thank you also for the kind words about the University of New Mexico. What you said, it is indeed not just the finest institution in New Mexico, but I'd like to think it's one of the finer higher ed institutions in the United States and in the world, because you know many of the folks who graduated from here have done great things for the state and for the nation and across. So, you know, obviously you're here for this wonderful event. I'm sorry, this is my third event. I have a fourth one to go to, so I just wanted to welcome you, and it is indeed an honor to welcome you back to your university, and enjoy the rest of the evening. Thank you again. Bye. Ms. Allen, where are you? Can you come up? I stand corrected. I didn't want to misappropriate the University of Mexico. One of the finest institutions. We used to keep on the WAC conference. Morning, like every year. I just wanted to mention that. Yes, ma'am, if you will.
Thank you, sir. Well, good evening, and as Chowkey mentioned, welcome back. For those of you that have returned for homecoming, and for those of you that are in the area, thanks for returning, I guess, to a more local locale. As Barbara mentioned, I am the Vice President of Alumni Relations here at UNM, but I also serve as the Executive Director of the Alumni Association. So that's the hat I'm going to wear at the moment, and just say how excited I was when Barbara and Sam reached out and asked me to come be a part of this. It was wonderful. I appreciate it. Thank you both so very, very much. I'm here about 8 months into my role at UNM and have had a great time of it all the way around. And these are two of the people who reached out to me very early on. And I've had a chance to get to know and get to understand more about what they're trying to do with this chapter and all the wonderful outreach and initiatives that they have spearheaded. So I want to thank them and you for everything that you do for the alumni of UNM and the current students here at the University of New Mexico. You're going to have a wonderful opportunity to hear from the president of your Alumni Association, James Lewis, here in just a few moments. So I won't take too much of his collateral, but one thing I will offer is that I was especially pleased in this past issue of our alumni magazine, The Mirage, to be able to do a nice feature on the Oral History Project. And I think that piece turned out so well. I'm just really excited about that. If you didn't get your copy and you are an alumnus, or if you are not an alumnus of UNM but you're interested in reading more about it, just let myself, Barbara, or Sam know, and we'll make sure that we get a copy in your hands. But it was a really nice feature on a really nice initiative, and I just thank you for undertaking that on behalf of the university. Again, have a great, great event this evening, and of course, the rest of homecoming weekend. If there's anything your alumni association and the alumni office can do for you, don't hesitate to ask. But for now, I'm going to turn the mic back over to you, sir. Thank you very much.
It's important that we consecrate what we're doing. So I'm going to bring up a faculty member from time to time. He is also
a community leader and minister and a few other things. I'll let him tell about himself. I don't like to brag on people, but he's a pretty good brother. I utilize him a lot of times to run some of the problems I have in my life through him. He ain't told me to go to hell yet, so I guess I'm all right. I want to present to you Dr. Charles, Reverend Dr. Charles McNeil.
The Bible tells us it's good to give thanks to the Lord. And that's what we're going to do at this time. We're going to put the Lord in this program. So let us bow our heads. Father God in heaven, we come right now in the precious matchless name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. First of all, Father, to say thank you. Thank you for these honorees, that they have represented us well. They came to the university, they completed their course of studies, went out and made contributions to their community. They're role models for others to follow. We thank the Black Alumni Association for recognizing these individuals. We know, Father, as they continue to make contributions in their communities and in their place of employment and to this university, you will be pleased with what they have accomplished. So, Father, we say thank you once again. They say thank you for all the good things that you've done in our lives. We give you the credit, we give you the honor, we give you the praise, we give you the glory. So bless this program tonight, Father, and bless all of those who are participating. And Father, we just pray too that as we go forth, that others will follow. We lay the groundwork for others to come to this university and make contributions to their community. So we say thank you. In the precious, matchless name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we thank you and we say amen.
Amen.
Thank you. I'm a graduate of Albuquerque High School. He was also the first African-American instructor at my high school. I didn't get a chance to experience an African-American teacher at Albuquerque High School. He came right after I left. I don't know if he was waiting until I leave or... But that was his story, so he's a piece of furniture, if I would say that. He's also an executive director of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. Moving on, UNM has a president of its alumni association. An individual I know pretty well. You probably do too as well. His name is James Lewis. We'll bring him up right now. You want to come up, Mr. Lewis? We go with 21-2, we go way back, so I'll let him tell you, I'll probably go back if he has time. And you don't.
You're doing great, Joe. Thank you. How you doing?
All right. We should be celebrating. Again, my name is James Lewis, and I say that because I like to feel energy. What this is all about, we used to talk about Black history lost, stolen, or straight. And I want to thank Barbara. I want to thank Sam. I want to thank Joe. When we look at Black history lost, stolen, or straight, it's very, very key. We don't have a large numbers here in the state of New Mexico. I'm a native. And when we talk about the quality, if you look at the distinguished athletes that have come into this state that made a difference, they went on and they made a difference to this country. And I just want to say to each and every one of them, the legacy, and when they talk about the old history, the history is for everybody. The history is for everybody, and so my concern is we need to let you know that we appreciate what you've done. You know, I used to come to the pit and we'd watch Petey there. Then you'll see somebody like Ira Hodge who said he'd build the pit and Mel Daniels filled the pit. So those are some of the living legends that we have around here. And I know that you're going to be honoring individuals like Judge Jewell, one of the first husband-wife bench on the bench on the district court. So give Judge Jewell a big round of applause for being on the district court. But let me just say a little couple things that we're working on with the Alumni Association. We need you. A lot of times, the people graduating from the university remain silent. They don't talk about this research institution. And we need you to let people know that this is one of the greatest research institutions in the United States. And we need you to help us recruit. We need you to help with scholarships. Dana, the executive director, we're actually traveling around. We've been to Denver. They just came back from Rutgers. They're doing outreach to all the alum in that area. And I've been concerned that we don't have a lot of the correct email addresses. We don't have the addresses where we can reach you, the telephone numbers. So we're trying to clean up our database with the foundation so that we can stay in touch. We can do some outreach, that we can ask you to come back and help us at the university as we speak about different issues and initiatives. So that's one of the things that we're trying to do, engagement. We're going to be in Dallas playing Air Force in the Cotton Bowl during the state fair. We've actually contacted a lot of the graduates in that area. One of the things, we were in Denver, I didn't see, and I called quite a few of our graduates from the African American community living in the Denver and the Colorado Springs area. We have over 5,700 graduates alum in that area. And trying to get them engaged. This is an institution that you should have your sons, your daughters, your relatives, encouraging them to come because of quality education. I'll ask a little trivia question right now. In the state of New Mexico, we have 5 members on the state Supreme Court. That's just the highest court in this land of New Mexico. All 5 of them graduated from our law school. All 5 of them. You know, we need to be telling that story to let people know that the quality is here. In addition to that, out of the 5, 3 of them are women. Women in the majority for the first time in the history of the state of New Mexico. So these are just things that I really encourage you. And it's not only in the discipline of law, but it's all across the board. New Mexico is recognized in our health sciences, in our medical field, in our athletics. So these are the things that we're asking you to help us with. And either call Dana or myself at the Alumni Association. As we're in your area, if we send you an invitation, we'd love for you to come out. You know, they do it in some of these other institutions, but for some reason, our graduates, they go and we don't really talk to them anymore. So we're trying to bridge that gap. We're trying to get you engaged. You can make the difference in a lot of the young folks' lives because they idolize you. You have been that symbol of greatness. So I just wanted to come here and tell you that I appreciate you. The University of New Mexico appreciates you. And thank you for what you've done on behalf of the University of New Mexico. Thank you.
That's all right. And we appreciate you, James. You know, history is being made as we speak. James is another first. He's the first African-American to be the president of the board, alumni board. Thank you. We're going to stretch him out, too. He's got a lot of resources. He's been the state treasurer for a number of years. And he's a native New Mexican. And I like that. I'm going to bring up Mrs. Jacqueline Asamoah. When I was a student here a number of years ago, almost 50, 45, somewhere off in there, we had an association, but it was unofficial. It was called SUB. But in those days, you know, we had conversation, we had dialogue among us. And it was unofficial in order that we took care of each other, we helped each other out, but things have progressed. Now you have a student association. So, Mrs. Jacqueline, if you want to come up, and she represents the Black Student Alliance of
University of Mexico. Come on.
Well, good evening, everyone. My name is Jacqueline Asamoah. It's nice to see the alum here and kind of like the, I guess the future, soon to be like a UNM alumni or alumna. So I just wanted to speak a little bit about what BSA is and kind of like our role on campus in terms of the voice of Black students and kind of looking at the climate of the UNM campus and kind of seeing what it's like for Black students to be here. So the Black Student Alliance is really a collective of Black student organizations on campus. So you have your Black Student Union, which I'm co-president of. You have Voices of Inspiration, you have Powerful Movement of Educated Sisters, you have Black Men in Motion, you have National Society of Black Engineers, you also have Student Athletics, and you also have Black Greek Life on campus. So it's pretty much a collective of all of the student leaders and also student members all over campus. And the reason, well, BSA had been brought up several times. It was kind of like an unofficial thing, like there were issues on campus, but we're trying to figure out, okay, we have these issues, how do we voice our opinion? How do we make the administration and the campus take us seriously? How do we kind of collect ourselves in an actual kind of structure to make sure we know what's going on, to make sure everyone around us, the students know what's going on, and administration kind of has a, they like things in like a neat box so to present it to them so we're kind of like all on the same page. So BSA was kind of brought up in terms of like a call to stand with solidarity with Mizzou when they were going with all of their issues that were happening. So Black Student Union actually held a blackout. We had our Black and Educated t-shirts, which are actually for sale tomorrow. So if you're interested in buying them, they're available. So we held a blackout just to stand in solidarity with Mizzou. And from that, we kind of collectively brought up and kind of structured our BSA a lot better because it was there, but we needed that structure. So that actually prompted a town hall last fall semester, and it held different UNM administration. The provost was there, athletics was there, several different departments from UNM were there to kind of hear exactly what was going on. The Black student experience is a big thing because students need to voice their opinion. They need to tell you the issues that they're facing and kind of get that out there. So at this town hall, we addressed the administration in terms of these experiences that students are feeling. Students actually had the opportunity to voice their opinion. They kind of had like a little open mic session and they kind of stated their experiences that they've had at UNM, whether it be microaggressions in the classroom, whether it be dorm life and having to deal with racist roommates and kind of just walking on campus at night and seeing things that no student, specifically a Black student, should see on campus, whether it be a noose hung up on like a tree or something that you shouldn't be seeing as a Black student on campus. So really, in terms of Black Student Alliance, we brought up these issues or demands that we wanted to see from the university in terms of issues that had to do with Black student experience. We also looked at the topic of diversity and culture training. That was a big thing because, like I said, students face a lot of microaggressions in the classroom, and it kind of hinders students from actually excelling or doing their best because you tell them, oh, maybe this class isn't for you. Maybe you should go to another field that's a little bit easier. And that kind of hinders students from doing things that they're supposed to be doing. We are also looking at the increase of Black faculty and staff on campus because UNM students, there's about a 4% population of Black students on campus. And then you look at faculty and it's about 2% on campus. So really trying to increase that, making it more representative of the population on campus, trying to make sure that there's a voice for students and faculty. Representation, recruitment, and retention were three of our big R's that we are really trying to focus on. Bringing in Black students and also Black faculty, big thing on campus. Keeping them here, bigger thing, because like I said, these microaggressions they face, if they don't feel comfortable in this environment, faculty doesn't want to stay here, or students. So really that kind of dwindles down and it reduces the amount of Black students and Black faculty we have on campus. And then the representation is a big thing because like I was saying, We see a lot of Black alumni here. It's nice to see that. We know that you guys have made it through, and that could be us one day, or faculty in a higher position. Oh, we could probably be that professor one day, or we could teach that class one day. We could actually be in the sciences rather than not really getting through because of these microaggressions that keep kind of like pushing us down. And we also looked at, like I said, the support of Black students, whether it be scholarships, whether it be internships, or the access to these resources that a lot of students don't really hear about, specifically Black students, because it's not easily as accessible. Because if Black students don't know where certain ethnic or research centers are, they're not going to hear about these opportunities, and they're going to go through college wondering, why didn't I get that opportunity that this next person got? And we're also just looking specifically at the climate report, which is a big thing that we brought up. The 2011 climate report that was done by President, it's been a while since I gave this speech, but the Black Climate Report, we were looking at it and it was like, why are these same issues back in like 2000, whatever, or the same issues that we're facing today? Obviously, you said that these are issues, so why hasn't there been a change to actually address all these problems that these students are facing on campus, or faculty are facing on campus? And with that, it gained a lot of attention, and we were actually able to house another town hall meeting to address the administration and say, hey, we gave you these demands or these issues, what are the changes? We're not seeing anything. And that also prompted another meeting with actually the regents. I was able to speak with the regents and actually address these same issues that I'm saying right now. And they were actually able to hear what we're saying, get what we're saying, and now we're pushing for results. Because we can keep talking and keep talking and keep talking, but if we're not seeing any results come out of it, we're wasting time. So I guess the next thing I just wanted to talk about briefly is kind of what BSA is doing now in terms of looking at the overall police brutality in terms of nationwide, and also still addressing Black campus climate. We're able to meet with Mayor Barry and some of APD and actually talk to them and hear about what they had to say in terms of the DOJ coming into Albuquerque and looking at the use of excessive force and analyzing that. It was a very interesting conversation. And we were able to kind of like guesstimate and kind of see, okay, this is their response. How can we take this and actually turn it around and actually use it for like purposeful reasons? So we're still coming up with kind of like different ways to go about addressing it. We kind of looked at our demands and issues that we had stated before, and we're kind of retailoring them and making them more specific and more detailed into how they can actually be addressed and accomplished. And then lastly, the one thing I wanted to touch on were the use of getting student voices heard and getting them involved, because like I said, a lot of Black students don't know where African American Student Services is, and that's fine, but a lot of Black students don't know where other Black students are, so they're kind of lost in this campus, because this campus has a majority of Hispanic people and a lot of Native American people as well. So if you don't identify with either, then you don't know where else to go. You feel kind of lost. So having that family or having that kind of like comfort to go through other students that are facing the same thing because they look exactly like you is one of those things that we're trying to focus on and getting more students involved, because that's what drives these the movements or structures of change are definitely student involvement. So that's one of the big things. And the last thing I just wanted to say was the equity and inclusion and their use of the Black Lives Matter discussion that they're doing right now. And we are really trying to hold them accountable for the department in general and looking specifically at what they do, what their purpose is, and how they can actually help us change this, or whether they can't help us change this and we need to go in another route. So looking at their discussion and holding them accountable for what they stand in terms of their diversity and their equity and inclusion is another thing that we're looking at. So been doing a lot, trying to get everything together. We're still students, so we kind of have to find time to meet with each other, but it's doable, and we'll get it done. So if you guys have any, you know, input that you want to give us or any help that you can assist with us, we really appreciate it because for students, we don't always know everything. So it's always nice to get outside help coming in. So with that, I just want to say thank you.
Are you shy? Are you shy? Okay. All right. I want to ask all the students who are in attendance tonight. Stand up. You got any students here? All right. You got good leadership. And if you're going to represent the legacy of this institution, you're going to have to be active. Harry Belafonte was here a couple of years ago, and I got a chance to chat with him. And one of the things he said about the University of New Mexico is that it was too quiet. Wasn't enough activity going on. He's an activist, so he looks at things from that perspective. So let's wake up, you know, and let's make UNM a part of the change of New Mexico. Students, how about some faculty? We got any of the African-American faculty here tonight? Where are they? Are all y'all standing at once? That's one. Two, thank you. All right. That's a new experience. When I was at the University of Mexico, there was not one. And both deans. Excellent. Next year, I'm going to put it on you guys, try to get more of your compadres. Mm-hmm. Let's do that next year. We're going to bounce around this program. I have the luxury of being able to invite or present to you the next speaker, who is a real resource to the state of New Mexico. Good brother, real good friend of mine. Y'all know him as Van Tate. I know him as a bunch of other things, but I can't. They're all good, though, Van. They're all good. But such a beautiful brother. He's pleasant. He's efficient. He's professional. He represents this institution really, really well, I think. Van Tate.
All right, how many of you guys ready to see some awards handed out? Yeah. We're going to have some awards, and we're going to do it at a pretty brisk pace. The reason we're moving the program around, I actually have to be at a football game in about a half hour. So it's football Friday night tonight, and so we're gonna get this started by giving out the Trailblazer Hall of Fame, Hall of Honor awards. And we're going to start with the guy I know who's, let me tell you a little bit about him. He'll probably remember this part of his history without saying his name. UNM halfback, set 12 records, 3-year starter at UNM. 43 he wore. That was his number. They retired that number, so you don't see 43 out there anymore. He already knows who it is. So if you don't know who it is, and I'm talking about you, then I got to talk to your wife after this. Get you some help. Inducted into the UNM Athletic Hall of Honor, the New Mexico Sports Hall of Fame, joined the National Football League, Dallas Cowboys in 1961, earned Rookie of the Year honors, and on September 24th, he became the first Cowboy running back to run for 100 yards. Is Don Perkins even here? I didn't think about that because I know I saw Don recently, and is he here? Is he not here? Okay. All right, let's move on to the next one. Another Don. It's not Corleone. And he knows who he is. Don Woods, UNM running back, voted most valuable player by his college teammates. New Mexico Sports Hall of Fame named him Athlete of the Year for his accomplishments that particular season. Later inducted into the UNM Athletic Hall of Honor. Drafted by the Green Bay Packers. Retired as a member of the San Francisco 49ers in 1980. Played 6 seasons with the San Diego Chargers also. Don Woods, come on up. He can still walk pretty good, man. I know he's running back. That takes a toll on you. You know, how many of you guys played football in college? Yeah, you guys know what I'm talking about. You saw me trying to get out the chair? Okay. So you all know. This guy really knows what I'm talking about. Ron Wallace.
I'm not that old.
I'm saying your knees, man. I'm talking about your knees. Come on, that's just a part of the territory. Your knees go. But you can still keep them going pretty good by sustained active. Well, I don't throw a few. All right, well, this next award goes to somebody known as UNM's most respected player on and off the football field, inducted into the UNM Hall of Honor also, and the New Mexico Sports Hall of Fame. Only linebacker ever drafted in the first round from this school, 21st overall. But he's the first, another linebacker that was drafted from the school. I guess Urlacher may have been drafted as a safety, but he was drafted in the first round also. Pittsburgh Steelers coach Chuck Noll took him. A key member of the Steel Curtain that led the Steelers to a couple of Super Bowl victories. 1990 Steelers, as far as 1980, that is, he was the Steelers' leading tackler, the defeat of the Los Angeles Rams. That would be Robin Cole. Is Robin Cole here? I didn't even see you sitting there. You came in here all stuff like, yeah. Robert, that was back in the day, wasn't it?
Oh, yes.
Next award goes to a guy who's pretty fast. I think he can still run pretty fast, but I'm not going to bet on him because I don't want to lose my money. I'm just trying to say that I think he can run fast. He might not. You just looked away. You know who I'm talking about. Preston Denard. Wide receiver, former wide receiver with the Lobos. First Lobo freshman to garner first team All-WAC honors. That's good, man. 1975, finished third in the nation in receiving. 1976, first team All-League. Now, upon leaving UNM, he held every receiving record at UNM because if you all know Preston, when he gets out to compete, he's very competitive and he's greedy. So he had all the records. Preston was like, I'm not leaving anything for anyone. They're all mine. Played 9 seasons with the Rams, Buffalo Bills, and Green Bay Packers. Started for the Rams in the 1980 Super Bowl. Nominated twice for NFL Man of the Year. Preston, come on up. That is his song. You know what? That's good theme music for Preston. I've known Preston for a long time. All right, the two trailblazers are here. First black athlete given a scholarship to UNM. So, yeah, trailblazer. Is UNM one of the first blacks to play the quarterback position, of course? Coached by the future Hall of Fame coach and NFL Buffalo Bills coach Marv Levy. So this guy has some miles. I remember Marv Levy coaching the Bills. They kept getting to the Super Bowl. He kept getting there, and didn't quite finish it. And that was a long time ago for even me. So, Charles P. Roberts, are you here? All right. There you go, man. Talking about you get out of that chair. There you go. Hey, Charles, you know about those knees, right? Let me keep talking about him while he's getting his award. Also earned the Go Lightly Award due to his contributions to UNM victory. Signed a free agent contract with the Rams in 1959, and due to a knee injury, unable to pursue a professional career. So he knows full and well about those knees. Inducted into the University of New Mexico Athletic Hall of Honor also. Congratulations, Charles. The next guy on the list, I don't see him out there. I don't know if he's here or not, but I'm going to call his man. Is he here? He didn't make it, because I actually played with him. Terrence Mathis, 1989, New Mexico's first consensus All-American after setting a Division I record for most receiving yards. Drafted by the New York Jets in 1990, played most of his NFL career with the Atlanta Falcons. You guys probably remember him running up and down the field. Those defenders, they remember him because they tried to catch him. And inducted into the New Mexico Sports Hall of Fame, Pro Bowl wide receiver in the NFL, VP of marketing for NASCAR's Levine Family Racing, and he was also inducted into the New Mexico Sports Hall of Fame. He also had part ownership of the Arena Football League here, the team that was here last year, they're still playing actually, the Gladiators. He was a part of that for a little while. Terrence Mathis is the next award winner. He's not here, of course, and so we'll keep moving on. I see Michael Cooper. Is Michael Cooper here? Okay. Michael Cooper, I think he needs no introduction. If you've been paying attention to basketball for the last 30 or 40 years, I mean, you know something about Michael Cooper because he was playing. Then he went on to have a lot of success as a coach. And he's coached in the NBA, the WNBA, NBA G League. Everywhere he's been a winner. And so two-time All-WAC selection, All-American honoree, led UNM to a conference title. That's when they had the 24-2 record. Drafted by the Los Angeles Lakers, played from 1979 to 1991, five NBA championships. So you guys remember the Showtime Lakers, right? Everybody's like, yeah. Named Coach of the Year for the WNBA in 2000. And of course, when he was playing, he was NBA Defensive Player of the Year, all-time first team defense also. And he too is in the New Mexico Sports Hall of Fame. Ira Hodge, Ira. You're here, aren't you? Oh, yeah, I see him. Ira looked at me like, I'm here, brother. I see you, man. I see you over there. I just talked to him recently. Saw him when the Lobo alumni game was going on. Recruited by UNM basketball coach Bob King, so he's got some stories. See, if we had more time, we could get you up here and just let you go, man, because I know you got good stories. He said he doesn't talk much, but I think we can get him going tonight. Achieved All-American honors while playing basketball at UNM, drafted by the 76ers of the NBA, was signed with the newly formed ABA, played on six league playoff teams, played on the 1968 ABA champion Oakland Oak team, and according to Bob King, not only did Eric, he did qualify for a, what does this say? Oh, he qualified to come to play basketball at UNM, it's just kind of a joke there. Lobo Mania front center. All right. Ira Hodge, also inducted into the New Mexico Sports Hall of Fame and UNM Athletic Hall of Honor. I'm looking out there to see if I know this next guy, if I know if he's here. And I don't see him. That would be Greg Brown. Is Greg Brown coming? Have you guys been in contact with him? You could give me his award and then I'll just tell him I put it on eBay. All right, Greg Brown. You guys remember Greg Brown. You probably remember him standing at the X that was marked just a little bit south of the half-court line and knocking down a shot from there. He won the 1994 Naismith Award given to the best male college basketball player under 6 feet. And that's what he was really doing. It was a guy named Penny Hardaway was coming out at the same time, so it kind of diminished his chances of making the Orlando Magic when Greg actually went to the Magic for training camp. Led UNM to the 1994 Western Athletic Conference regular season title for the first time in 16 years. 1993-94 named WAC Player of the Year, leading the team in scoring and assists. Also inducted into the UNM Athletic Hall of Honor and the New Mexico Sports Hall of Fame. So I will let Greg know that he has an award here. And you guys have been in contact with him. I'm going to tell him I took it home.
Okay.
All right, I see this next guy. There he is. He said, don't look at me like that. All right, Petey Gibson. Edward Petey Gibson. Known for shooting the last second shot that beat New Mexico State Aggies in 1970. You know what? You heard a lot of people down there when you shot that, man. They still haven't gotten over it. He was recognized by UNM with the Zia Award as an outstanding alumni in community service. In recognition of his community service, now Governor Bill Richardson signed a proclamation on October 1st of 2003, making it Petey Gibson Day, and I do remember that because we actually covered that. Albuquerque La Mesa Elementary School recognized his service by naming a building after him, the Petey Gibson Building. That's pretty good, man. You got a building. We could go hang out there, huh? Petey's got a building, y'all. How many of you all have a building? See? There's nobody else raise their hand. Man, you're going to live in large. All right. Also inducted into the Albuquerque Sports Hall of Fame. Let's give it up for Petey Gibson.
go.
With a ladder, right? Steps to him.
Don't do that.
He just no dunk, huh? Yeah, you got people vouching for you out here. You got a building, that's what's tea. They know you have a building, man. That's what's going on right there. All right, the next person out, somebody I know really well, and I don't see him out there. But I'm going to have to send him a text and say, hey, man, where were you tonight? And that's Kenny Thomas. Kenny Thomas, who's a basketball player here in New Mexico, one of the highest profile recruits ever to attend UNM. Second on the UNM all-time scoring list, career blocks list, career dunks list, and leads the list in career rebounds. I knew all that because Kenny reminds me. He lets me know all about that. Kenny, in case you guys didn't know, you've drafted, of course, to the NBA, went to the Houston Rockets, spent some time with the Philadelphia 76ers, Sacramento Kings, his last contract with the Kings, actually. You know, these guys make this money, you just like, what do you do with all that money? 7 years, $58 million. What would you, I mean, like, give me a million. That's, it doesn't have to be 50, you know what I mean, right? One of five Lobos to be selected as All-American in 1998. Played on the gold medal winning team, World University team in Trapani, Italy. Drafted, of course, I talked about that, in 1999 by the Rockets. 11 NBA seasons, inducted into the New Mexico Sports Hall of Fame. So we're going to have to talk to Kenny. I'll let Kenny know he won an award. That wouldn't be on EB, too. All right. Next, I know this lady very well. And she, let me just tell you something about her before I name her. I remember being in a Mountain West tournament. And Lobo's chances of winning for women's basketball, it was pretty good. But her and this other girl, they got out there on the court, and they destroyed the other team. It was humiliating what they did. She had like 20-something rebounds and 20-something points. I was like, I mean, it was a sister night. They went crazy out there. I mean, it was one of those nights. Dion Marsh, McDonald. Yes, of course, McDonald's just got married since last time you guys seen her on the court tearing it up. Named Mountain West Conference Newcomer of the Year 2004-2005. And that, if I'm not correct, that was, if I'm not mistaken, that was when you were a freshman, right? I remember Dion getting some playing time after somebody got injured. We were just going like, when is she going to get some playing time? They finally put her out there and she tore it up. She's held a 92-37 record over 4 years at UNM. All-time leading scorer with 1,913 points, four-time Mountain West all-academic selection, too. So she did it in the books also. You're keeping the kids straight on there, right? Yeah. They got to get that homework done, right? Okay. Nominated by the Mountain West Conference for the 18th Annual NCAA Woman of the Year Award. So she played professionally in Athens, Greece in 2008, signed with the Sacramento Monarchs of the WNBA also in 2008. Inducted into the New Mexico Sports Hall of Fame. This guy is fast. I think he's still fast. I think Joe might be the fastest guy in the room, but Renee Madison?
Yeah, I like to run anybody in here.
So you challenge Joe. You challenge Joe, he's ready to go. All right, Renee, let's talk about you. Earned All-American twice in track and field, led New Mexico to many track victories, played football for 1 year at UNM. What was that like? Yeah, drafted in the round 13 by the Dallas Cowboys. At least you were drafted, man. That's pretty good. Received the UNM Zia Award for community work and also inducted into the Indiana Track and Field Hall of Fame and inducted into the UNM Athletic Hall of Honors. Pretty good. Can you still run real fast? Did I say it right? All right, the doctor's in the house. Errol Bailey gave me that look like, all right, man, what you about to do? I'm going to behave, man, I promise. Three-time track and field letterman, part of many UNM track and field victories, former director of UNM Black Studies, the current president of the Albuquerque NAACP. This man's doing it on the track and off the track. Great accomplishments. Dr. Errol Bailey. I'm at the end of my list. And I guess they say the best for last, huh? Laverne Clark Roberts. Long and triple jumper, you hear? Here's Laverne. Oh, come on up, Laverne. I won't bite you, I promise. I did have something to eat before I got here. She said, I don't know, he might do something. No, I'm not. I'll be all right. Well, in case you want to know more about her, here it is. Only New Mexico field athlete to earn All-American honors and one championship, won five conference titles during her 3 years at UNM, won a long and triple jump at the High County Athletic Conference Championships, seized individual crown in indoor triple jump at the WAC Outdoor Championships. Nice, 1990. Coaster, okay. She's wanted to make that clear. She coached, okay. And I do believe that's all the awards. And I hate to do it. I hate to duck out on you guys. I wish I could stay for the whole thing, but it's no joke, man. Friday nights, you all would not believe it if you saw it. Like a lot of the highlights that we're doing, I see them when you see them. I mean, I'm dead serious. Like the game's in late and stuff like that, and I'm getting out there and. Some of the guys that went to this game or that game, they just hand me some notes, and I'm like looking at them like, when you're looking at them. And so it's a crazy, it's already been a crazy day. I've been at work since 9:30 this morning. And so it's been one of those days. That's how it is during football season. Well, thank you. Thank you all. Thank you all for having me. Once again, got a headline.
I just wanted to, as president of the Black Alumni Chapter, to thank Mr. Tate for coming out tonight and participating in the ceremony. We wanted to make it special for this elite group of Hall of Famers, Hall of Honor recipients, and there was no better person than Van Tate to do this. He accepted right away, and he's on his way to a high school football game now. And so we appreciate two of them coming in and spending time this afternoon and tonight with us to do these honors. Thank you so much.
$50 slave.
That's all right. Van, good to see you, man. It's a pleasure to have you. Y'all watch Channel 13 every once in a while.
So we've deviated a little bit in the program. Man.
So I guess to add some clarity to what this program is really all about, I'm going to bring up the president of the Alumni Association, let her elaborate a little bit. And I'm going to bring up Ms. Barbara Simmons.
I'm not going to take too much time. We decided to switch the agenda around because we knew that Van had to go to another event. I'm just going to talk briefly about the history of the Black Alumni Chapter. How the Black Alumni Chapter got started, it really was based on a project that Sam and I and Dean Roberts and Dr. Charles Bedell did in 2010 on the 40th anniversary of the Black studies program. We did a 40th anniversary film. And during that time, Sam and I was going to Zimmerman Library to do research, and we couldn't find much on the Black student movement, Black history, Black anything. And we said, wow, you know, we're lost. I don't think we were stolen. I think we were just lost. So we decided to form this alumni association. And one of our main goals is to fill that void in Zimmerman. Later I'll talk about our oral history project. And so we got started in 2011, thanks to Brother Scott Carruthers, because we needed a faculty person on campus. And Scott has worked with us side by side since 2011. Thank you.
Real simple, moving on. Our mission and purpose is simple. is to preserve the history of the Black student civil rights movement. More important, to sustain the ability of African student services and Black student departments. The hard time when Bob and I, we came back 40 years later, when it should be a department, it's still a program. Something we have to do. So we decided to institutionalize it. Then Dr. Harold Bailey, that when he was the director of the State of Affairs from New Mexico, he decided to do that documentary with his office and put it out. And you can find it in a public library. But we are very serious. And lastly, but not least, our last purpose is to the recruitment and retention of African American students to this university. This is our university. I am proud of this university. We did so much here, blood, sweat, and tears. There was a race riot in 1970. First time the school was closed. 2 months later, African American students opened their doors to come and study Native American. I didn't say the race riot did it, but it had to do with the sustainability, and we wanted to be not as individuals on campus, but we wanted to say we have a right to join this campus as Black people. Thank you.
Moving right along, you know, to every event, every activity, there is an expense. And for every expense, there is a monitor of the expense, usually called a treasurer. And another athlete, student, graduate of the University of New Mexico, friend of mine, didn't like him at first. But he's so sincere in what he does, you know, you have to appreciate him for that. This is a very good friend of mine, Mr. Stan Mosley. He's going to talk to you about Monet.
First, I'd like to thank you all for attending our fifth annual awards reception and ceremony. So if you would give yourselves a hand. The Black Alumni Chapter has already been talked about by Barbara and Sam. It was an initiative of alumni, of Black alumni students to come back to UNM and to give back, because again, it was appalling for us to find out there was nothing in the Zimmerman Library concerning some of these folks that we just recognized here. Nothing concerning anything that has to do with how Black studies or African American student services or Africana studies came about in UNM. We also found out that what we wanted to do was make sure that some of these things would be left behind before we exited this world. We came back to give back. We found out that if one of the reasons that Black students in the state of New Mexico or around the country could not attend this great university was because they could not afford to. So we have put together and decided to sponsor a scholarship fund. The scholarship fund is called the Josephus Long, or Joe Long Scholarship. He was the first Black student union president at UNM back in 1967. He was instrumental in all of the things that we now, our students now, realize and appreciate and have here at UNM. Joe Long received his Master's of Arts degree from UNM in 1970. Mr. Long is no longer with us. He passed away. He lost his bout with cancer. Some influential people that you might know the former state treasurer and now president of the Alumni Association Board, Mr. James Lewis, the UNM president, Mr. Robert Franks, Mr. Henry Nemczyk, who is the founder of the, he is the president of the foundation, have seen if necessary and appreciate what we're doing and have donated and contributed to this Joe Long Scholarship. Not only influential people like those three and Mr. Joseph Prodrell, but everyday people like Ms. Angela Cross and a student at UNM by the name of Nguyen has contributed over $1,000 each to themselves to our scholarship fund. We, the Alumni Association, the Black Alumni Association, do not ask you to do anything that we ourselves are not doing. Each member has pledged $1,000 to the scholarship fund. Thank you. Now, what makes all of those influential people and all those everyday folks equal as far as this scholarship is concerned? Once this scholarship is endowed, it lives on forever. You become part of something that will never go away. As long as UNM is here, this scholarship will be here. A lot of us admire all of these athletes and the things that they have accomplished. We could never be a part of any and all of that, but we can become a part of something that will never, never go away. So, to end this plea to you, I will be stationed outside to discuss the purpose of the Joe Long Scholarship. Mr. Long himself, any of our board members will be available to talk to you about it and to receive your donations. Thank you.
I was kidding. James always been a good friend of mine. Thank you, Stan. You don't have any money on you because we don't want to have to guard you to your car. We've raised over $19,000 thus far. Is that correct? So any of you that are feeling the spirit, let's do that. I want to mention something. You know, I was a walk-on at the University of New Mexico. I wasn't the recipient of a scholarship. Probably didn't want it at the time, but I had a scholarship that I got from Eleanor Roosevelt put some money together, and it was for an African-American student, Negro student at the time. And money is important. That's the point I want to make there. So you got it, give it up. It'll be worth everything that you put into it. Want to move again a little farther here? The Charles P. Robert Fellowship. Nobody knows any more about that than Mr. Roberts himself. You want to come up, sir? And you have the honor of presenting. Okay, I'm all right to leave this with you.
Hello, my name is Glenda Lewis. Happy to be here tonight. I want to thank the Black Alumni Association for awarding me the first recipient of the Charles P. Robbins Fellowship. I'd also like to thank each of you in the room tonight for all your hard work, your contributions, and for paving the way for students like myself to follow my dreams and to be the first. Tonight I stand before you as the first UNM Black Graduated Professional Student Association President. I was motivated by each of your efforts. Doing that archiving project, I had the privilege of going through the Daily Lobos and extracting information that I would have never known about had I not had the privilege and the opportunity. Mrs. Simmons, Mr. Johnson, and the rest of you are part of the Alumni Association afforded me that opportunity to learn. I've been sharing that knowledge. Anytime I come across young students, I share a little bit of the tidbits that I learned. Because back in the day when I was working at Mr. Padre's on 4th Street, and Joe and Rita would share with me stories, and I would say, all of that happened to you and him? Who are these people? Where are they at? And eventually, I was able to learn more. So I'm thankful. Thankful for your contributions. Thank you all for doing what you've done. And thank you for continuing to be role models and heroes, not just for me, but for all the other young people coming up and all the old people out there who should be doing more. Thank you all. Thank you very, very much.
Old people.
And I'd also like to thank Dean Roberts because he definitely treaded the way. And UNM is still, even though there were two black deans in attendance here this evening, I think what UNM has, those two and maybe one more, and this is 2016. So we have a long way to go, but because of all your efforts, we're moving. We're moving, and we need to move faster, but I'm here to say thank you very much because all of your contributions have motivated and continue to motivate me on a daily basis. And I thank you very much, thank Dean Roberts for his contributions to this great institution, and looking forward to all the endeavors of the next fellow.
Linda was our first recipient of Charles Roberts Fellowship. Obviously, money well invested. I want to thank the board, the Black Alumni Chapter, the board, Barbara, Sam, and Renee, Stan, Helen,
Doris.
Hey, Doris. I'm running with you, okay. But anyway, for their efforts to obtain the money to really provide the fellowship through the years. And now I think we're ready for a new recipient. Two recipients. Leroy Holmes and Hilda Solange DePoe Payne.
Actually, we had two. We had Demetrius, and then we had Ashley. So this is our fourth recipient. Just to say a little bit about the Charles P. Roberts Fellowship. Actually, it was Dr. Harold Bailey who went into the Center for Regional Studies and got the money for this scholarship. The recipients received $15,000 per year to assist with their education as graduate students. So if you multiply 15 by 5, we've done a pretty good job.
It takes money. You know, it's all about business. It's all about an investment in our future. And it's happening here. Y'all be aware of it. And when you get your spirit, move on it. You know where to find Stanley? If you can't find Stanley, find me. I'll find Stanley. Okay. Ms. Simmons, we want to do some trailblazers right now.
Our trailblazers this year, we've now completed the Jewel family. We've honored Angela. We've honored Tommy Jewel Sr. And it doesn't mean you're last Tommy in our hearts, but now we honor Tommy Jewel. Would you come up, Tommy?
Just a little about Tommy. Tommy was a test case. When I say a test case, that was affirmative action back then, where they could not just use the LSAT and your GPA to decide whether you could enter law school, because we decided to cover your body. But because of help like Dean Robertson and other director of Black Studies during that time, and I was adamant about Tommy coming to law school. I told him you graduated from New Mexico State, you know, played football. And plus, he was one of the founding members of Ada Ada Chapter of Omega Psi Phi. So I had a personal interest. There was some problem, but there wasn't any problem, because we said this would be one of the black males that would graduate and probably set a precedent in the state of New Mexico. He graduated, became the first black judge in the state. But before then, I'm saying public, I hooked him up with Angela. He said, she's pretty. I said, she's very stern. Both of them were in law school together. And both of them graduated, first couple to become judges, and then becoming first female judge. So my point is that Tommy and his wife were an example that we proved to a system that was institutionalized with racism that we are smart. We are just as intelligent that we have the same resources as the other ethnic group had. Did not have the same resources, but we knew we had to deal with it twice as much. And also, those that visit the law school, Tommy is one of the blacks that sits as distinguished at our law school, UNM Law School. I am so proud of Tommy. He said, Sam, you think I can make it? I said, you gotta make it. You wanna keep Angela's girlfriend? No, Father, we are so happy to present Tommy. He is a trailblazer.
Thank you, Barbara. Thank you, Sam. Thank you, Black Alumni Association. I think we know who the true trailblazers are, and particularly at UNM Law School. And I sincerely appreciate the encouragement that I received from you both. In accepting this award, I certainly have to recognize the other half of the tandem, Judge Angela Jewel. We've been married 35 years now. She city continues to get more and more beautiful each day. I don't know, once you marry somebody 35 years, you look at them and you see beauty in every one of those years, in addition to the physical beauty that you see before your eyes. So thank you, Angela. And I wanna say thank you, Tommy Jewell Sr. He remains an inspiration at 91, coming into the law office every day. We appreciate his example. And, you know, I look out in this audience and see all the trailblazers that paved the way for me. The next awardee is certainly one, and certainly I don't want to steal the thunder there, but he remains a trailblazer for others. Ray has helped so many of the young lawyers coming in our profession that he deserves mention, and I just wanted to give that mention to him. So I want to thank you all for this accolade. Perhaps I am not deserving, but will work steadfastly to continue to blaze trails. Thank you.
Thank you. I am going to let Barbara, because we know Attorney Ray Hammond so well. I'm going to give Barbara the pleasure of introducing him, because I don't know which direction to go, because he's so outstanding. So, Madam President.
Well, first of all, I've been knowing Raymond 50 plus years, and we used to hang out and party together back in the day. Raymond, Dr. Charles Bicknell, and myself opened the Black Studies office in August of 1970. The first day that the doors opened, there sat Raymond Hamilton, Charles Bicknell, and Barbara Brown. And I must say that Charles moved that program way ahead of where we thought it would go at that time. Raymond is, I call him Mr. Attorney at Law. When I look at his resume, he's been the first everything you can imagine. First on the Board of Bar Examiners. We used to hate them. First on the Board of Commissioners. And you know, he graduated from Harvard Law School. And I mean back in the day when it was really hard to get in Harvard. Also, he's the first African-American assistant United States attorney in the District of New Mexico. And while he held that position, they made him chief of the Civil Division. Can you imagine that? For the New Mexico District. All along and on about Raymond, and when I nominated him, he said, "Well, you know, I don't like awards. Why did you nominate me?" I said, "This is not just an award, Raymond, because all of these recipients are candidates for our oral history program that we're going to talk about later. We plan on inducting all of you into our oral history project in Zimmerman. So it will become more than just an award. I would like to introduce at this time my friend, my mentor, Mr. Ray
law student when we first met, and
In 1982, we formed the New Mexico Black Lawyers Association. One of our legacies. It's lived on and shall live on. And I think two of our officers are here tonight, Asia Brooks. Asia not only is our former president of the New Mexico Black Lawyers Association, current vice president, there's a board of bar commissioners that governs all 6,000 lawyers here in the state of New Mexico, and she's on newly elected to the board of bar commissioners for the state of New Mexico. Shamara Henderson is also here. I don't see her. She's another vice president. Oh, there she is. Stand up, stand up. So what we've got here are young leaders who will take over leadership in the bar, take over leadership of the New Mexico Black Lawyers Association, and be stalwarts in the community. So we're very proud of our young attorneys. I do not like to receive awards because I think the duty of all of us is to strive for the greater good, to work for the greater good. I think that's our human purpose. And why should you get a reward for working for the greater good? I'd also like to say that part of working for the greater good is resisting bad. Part of working for the greater good is resisting bad. And when you have a person, for example, I'll give you two examples. When you have a person who epitomizes the first black resident of the United States of America and questions his birthright, then you need to push back against the person. You gotta stand up and push back against the bad. That's part of striving for the good. I'll give you a final example that the attorneys here in New Mexico are facing, and there's been a new bar exam put in place. It's called the Uniform Bar Exam. It's been in place for 2 years now, and blacks are failing like a wildfire cutting through a forest. Native Americans and blacks and Hispanics, we had some zero pass rates here. So you got to push back against things like that. And you don't have to go out looking for the bad, it will find you. So part of doing good is pushing back against the bad. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Now, Mr. Chairman, with that tone.
Okay.
Congratulations, Ray. Tommy. Proud of you. When I get beat, I want to be just like you.
No, Joe, we don't want you to close out until closing remarks. We're going to let you have the last word. The next part and the last part of our program has to do with our oral history project. The Black Alumni Chapter's oral history project, we created a series of 10 DVDs, and we had outstanding black alums who achieved great things in the state of New Mexico and nationally to come in, sit before a camera, and tell your life story from birth to the present. But we gave them a framework. It was called the Civil Rights Movement, Breaking the Color Barrier Through the Decades. We had some very, very interesting stories. And some of our interviewees are here tonight: Ira, Charles McNeil, Dr. Bailey, Angela, myself, Tommy Jewell Sr., and we had 10, so I promise forgetting somebody. But I was so amazed at these stories. We all talked about breaking the color barrier and facing racism in the 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000, 2016, but they were all different. We it wasn't a repeat. My racist experience wasn't the same as Charles, even though sometimes generally it was. And so that was the amazing thing about these oral history DVDs. These DVDs are now a part of a special collection at Zimmerman Library. It's called the Black Alumni Chapter Oral History Project. You can go online and view them, all 10 of them, or you can go to the library and look at a DVD and read the transcripts. We intend to add to this collection. We're already seeking funds now in the state of New Mexico, where I'm told it, the state's broke. But we're now seeking funds to make sure we do the next 10 this year. And that's why when I said to Raymond, this is not just an award. Our recipients are the people that we look at to do these DVDs on. And there are some people that really helped us along the way. I'd like for Scott Carruthers, where are you, Scott? Come on up here. I want Scott up here because Scott's the director of African American Studies. I started this passion for this oral history archives in 2011. And the person that has stood with me every day, and there was days I thought I was going to get him fired, every day was Brother Scott Carruthers. Because you see, this was easy. I started out with Rita Padrell and Dr. Harold Bailey. We were the archives committee for the Black Alumni Chapter. And as I said, Harold went in and got the research funds for our fellows, and Rita educated me. I knew nothing about being a historian. I knew nothing about an oral history project, but it was something that I visioned and I wanted to do. So Rita patiently educated me, because I was constantly calling and asking questions. And sometimes I think I was repeating myself. But Rita was very patient, and she helped me to develop the framework from which to work in. And then Susan Roberts gave me a phone number, made a phone call for me to the dean's office in Zimmerman, so all the doors were open so that I could walk right in and talk to the dean of Zimmerman and the dean of special collections about this project. That was the easy part. The next 4 years, I went to meetings, I went to the Center for Regional Studies, who I knew were doing oral history projects and other groups, but we kept getting turned down. And then finally, we met with President Carlos Romero, who's the Vice President of Research here at UNM. And he was an administrator that agreed that this program should exist. And the reason Scott and I ended up in his office is because they had denied our application for the Charles P. Roberts Fellowship and closed the door on our project. So Scott and I filed a formal appeal. We were now the Barbara Simmons and Scott Carruthers versus the University of New Mexico. Anyway, we had a lot of appeals meetings, and one day we got a phone call. This was transferred from the Vice President of Research to the Office of the Provost. And once the provost got involved, things started to move. We had a committee, we had money, we had a timetable, and we had a director of Center for Regional Studies who did the 125th anniversary of the university field. She was the director of our project. We got Marsha Hardiman as our interviewer, and Preston Private members, Preston Adard. A few years ago when I was first starting out, I had a breakfast meeting with Preston, and I wanted him to be our interviewer, but 4 years later, I'm pretty sure Preston thought this had gone by the wayside. But anyway, Marsha Hardiman was our interviewer. Scott Carruthers, Dr. Ralph Jefferson from African Studies, we used his facilities, and we got this done. And the people who were involved in this project, as I said, were working to do another 10. Some of these other 10 right in here tonight. So we hope that you will look at these DVDs. I will be emailing out the website number. Also, if you receive the Mirage, in the Mirage, the latest Mirage, the UNM magazine, right in the middle, there's a picture of Dean Roberts, and it says, Preserving History. And it talks about all of our recipients and the purpose of this project. So if you know alums who you think we ought to be looking at and talking to, we want to recognize all of our Black alums who deserve to have their story told. And most people deserve to have them told, but we just want you to recognize people who've done things that blaze trails for Black people, you know. And when Tommy's on the bench, they open the door for others. When Raymond's in the United States Attorney's Office, it opened the door for others. So I'm so pleased to see so many people out. I know it was these gentlemen in the front row here who brought you out, but we're glad to see you. And let me tell you, I am always so proud of the athletes that have come through UNM. I remember I had just relocated to Los Angeles when Robin Cole for the Pittsburgh Steelers and Preston Lennard for the Los Angeles Rams was playing in the Super Bowl. So I would jump up when the Rams do something, and then I would jump up when the Pittsburgh. And they said, whose side are you on? I said, both. So I'm so glad that you all took the time to come out tonight, because this made this event a success. And as I said, we'll be calling you about these oral history projects, and if you know other people who you think we ought to be nominating for these awards, just let us know. You have anything to say, Scott? Now, I know some people are in the audience, so if Rita Fidrell is here, I'll just call out the names of the people who we want to give a certificate of appreciation to. If you're here, just come up and get it. If not, I'll get them to you. Dr. Harold Baby. I'm going to see you from Rick. Rita Fidrell. Dr. Evans. I don't think I see Marcia Hardeman. I don't see, okay. If Marcia's not here, I think that's it. Dr. Josie DeLeon and Dean Mike Kelly. R.C. Chapa. Are you gonna receive the award for someone? For Josie? Anyway, a big thanks to all of the people who made this project a success. And this project was my bucket list. I don't plan to kick the bucket, but it was my bucket list.
Each and every one of y'all for coming out tonight. I know it was during the Balloon Fest, but you made a sacrifice for that. I just want to note one thing. The young lady over here at the graduation hostel, her mother is Brenda People. We all was in the struggle together during the 60s and the 70s. And I told Brenda when she was 8 years old, she's going to law school, and she's a graduate now. So I thank you all for coming.
Let me say thank you as well. You know, it's history being made. I think the objective, one of the objectives also is to say that to be able to make a contribution to an institution is really an honor. Those individuals that have been recognized tonight have done that. You do it in your own manner of speaking, and it's appreciated. I'll say that. And to the students, you know, try to live in the legacy of this great college. It's important. And lastly, I just want to say that, you know, the virtue of perseverance, which is really what this is all about, is a struggle. Gotta love the struggle, else you don't get anywhere. That's what's happening here. We stop every year annually just simply to say that, you know, we're still moving. So thanks everybody for coming. Y'all take this and share it with the people that didn't come here tonight, and we'll go forward like we always do.
But before we leave, he's hiding. I think he's in the back. Did he just walk out? The new dean of the UNM Law School, co-dean, black dean, Alfred Matheson. Thanks for coming. Thanks for coming. Also, we just want to introduce our board. Stand up right quick. Helen Hamilton, Renee Madison, Doris Willis, Sam Johnson, Barbara Stevens, Dr. Levins, Dr. Robert Jefferson. Thank you so much. And I want to say to you athletes, don't all leave. I want to take another picture without the award.
Oh, Renee, we have to repeat you up here.